I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's premier home purchase lender. We've created a new way to protect you from unpredictable interest rates. Our exclusive Rate Shield approval. First, we lock your interest rate for up to 90 days. Then, if rates go up, your rate stays locked. But if rates go down, your rate drops. Either way, you win. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
Rate Shield approval only valid on certain 30-year fixed rate loans. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030. Additional conditions or exclusions may apply.
Hey everybody, this is Laura. Did you know that Bob thinks the saying goes, a cupcake a day will keep the doctor away?
It does. And folks, you know what doesn't stay away is top rope belts and turnbuckle cupcakes from this program. That program being live from the Armory Wrestling Show. You've heard Laura and I talk about top rope belts, turnbuckle cupcakes for the last 5 years. Make sure that you're supporting your local independent wrestling business that supports the business, if you get what we're saying. www.topropebelts.com. Go to www.turnbucklecupcakes.storenv.com. Make sure you're supporting your local independent wrestling businesses. What do you think, Laura?
Have you heard about the one?
Yeah, the one about the cupcakes, yeah.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
He looked like a battery-operated boyfriend is who he looked like. He was just awful.
Oh, God. He looked horrible.
Okay.
Disclaimer warning coming out. I can feel it.
This portion of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show is brought to you by AdamandEve.com.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
I'll bring duct tape, rope, whatever it takes.
And the lovely Laura.
What kind of things are you into? You got duct tape and rope? Have you been buying stuff from Adam and Eve?
Well, folks, you know, every now and then we pull a surprise. We pull a rabbit out of the hat, and this is a pretty big rabbit. I mean, I think it's a big rabbit, don't you?
It's like huge.
It's a huge, not like a teeny bunny, but a big. Well, never mind about all that, folks. This is a special episode. We had the opportunity. Laura and I had the opportunity to have a guy on the show that we've been wanting to get on for some time because longtime listeners of this program know that we are both huge NWA fans from way back in the day. The relaunch of the NWA happened, you know, Billy buys the company, all this stuff starts circulating around, and it's always been in the back of our mind, what if? Well, what if we got Dave Lagana, the vice president of the National Wrestling Alliance, on this program? And guess what?
We did.
Folks, I think that you're going to get a lot out of this. I know that Laura and I did. It was an absolute honor to have Dave come on the show and talk about the NWA, past, present, and future. Without any more from myself or Laura, we hope that you will enjoy Dave Lagana of the NWA. Ladies and gentlemen, Laura and I are very, very excited to have this special guest on with us. It's quite an honor to be able to have this gentleman on the show. Fans that are longtime listeners of the program know that we are huge NWA supporters from way back in the day. The gentleman that's joining us is a producer, a writer, a director. He has worked for WWE, Ring of Honor, TNA, and he is currently the vice president of the National Wrestling Alliance. We would like to welcome to the show Mr. Dave Lagana. Dave, thank you so much for taking time out to be with us.
No problem. Nice to be on.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Dave, it wasn't that long ago that the NWA was struggling on all fronts, and fans like myself and Laura wondered what would become of the promotion. Here we are in 2019, and the future looks incredibly bright. Has there been a time, a moment that you've just sat back and said, man, what a whirlwind?
Yes and no. There are pockets of moments, but thankfully the work, I just took a pause to finish 10 pounds of gold that's going to go up tomorrow morning at the same time tickets go on sale for Crockett Cup, you know, to look back at moments and, you know, to go to China this year with the NWA title, which something that nobody ever did, you know, for Nicholas to the title in China, then to All In, to then the anniversary show, then to our pop-up event. You know, we are not a traditional wrestling company. And it's almost the number one knock that people who don't understand what we're doing, and everything we've done has been done in plain sight, but under this guise of, well, what are they up to? This guy literally messages me once a month. Any news on a national television deal, you know, and in 2019, 2020, a national television deal is not the same as getting a national television deal in 1999. And by the way, point of reference, it was a national television deal that ended ECW. You know, you have to have a product that people really want to see. And for us, the moment we step back and go, wow, people do care, and to focus on what they care about. And I think where the past versions of the NWA, all the way back, all the way to, you know, and I'm editing about the Crockett era, I think where things got lost is people sort of went into the weeds of what they thought the NWA was. But ultimately what we think it is the 10 pounds of gold, and the energy that is as a brand that those three letters in that logo stood for 70 years.
And that those are very valid points. And speaking of the 10 pounds of gold, we've had the opportunity to speak with former NWA champions like Tim Storm and Jack Stain, as well as the current NWA women's champion Jazz. And in talking with them, the one overlying tone was the responsibility of carrying those titles, the legacy did not go unrecognized by them. What are your thoughts on working for this promotion, both from a professional standpoint and a personal standpoint?
The letters are bigger than us. You know, names like Mushnick, Fez, Flair, Rhodes, you know, these are pillars of our business. And to see names that most people never would have heard of, to use it for their own personal playground, to say I was in the NWA, I have a distinct responsibility. So does Billy. So does Nick. So does Tim Storm. So does Jack. So does Jazz. Anybody that is moving forward with us, understand the weight of this. You know, that shield is as important as that of the NFL and as of that of any major brand. It needs to be honored and cherished and not used for a personal playground. And so each of those people you mentioned have a distinct responsibility to carry forward the tradition and legacy that was carried forward from 1947 on. It's why for our first event, the words tradition and legacy were on the side of the ring, bigger than our logo, because that is what we stand upon. And it still means something to an audience, and those values mean something. And in a world where people fight over politics and fight over a lot of stuff that doesn't matter, we want to put forward a product that matters to those who it matters to. We are not banging our chest saying we're going to compete with the WWE. How could you? How could you?
Right.
Because their legacy, while not as long as that of the NWA, Vince McMahon has often said he's out of touch. He just, in a time where people say that often, he just closed the biggest one-year earnings report in the history of the company. And I hope when I'm 73 years old, I'm that out of touch with a business that successful, because you have to have a successful business to have a wrestling company. And people always argue, oh, the booking's so bad. Okay, great. You're still watching it. It must be not that bad, or we're all really big gluttons for punishment. And I always say, like, that show Empire, I loved the first season. Then the second season, it didn't do anything for me. And it ran me off. And guess what? I didn't go back. I didn't start a blog about it. I didn't tweet incessantly about how terrible it is. I just gave up on it. And I think there are fans who have given up on the WWE, and that's everyone's right. And I think I read every bit of feedback we get. And a lot of people say they haven't watched wrestling in 20 years, 10 years, 5 years, and that they associate some energy to our brand. And I'm very happy with that. Do I think that's enough to create a mainstream appeal? No. I think we need to be – it's why our product is kind of stupid simple, where we don't try to overload you with too much. We want you to understand what's important and what's not.
That makes sense. Well, I've got something about the WWE, but we'll get to it in a moment. One of the factors that deserves mentioning at the beginning of this interview is the 10 Pounds of Gold series, which you've alluded to. When sitting down with the ideas for this series, how did the creative process work, and how do you think that this series has helped move or present the NWA product to today's fan?
I think it is created for a modern day content. If somebody asked me this the other day, I'm not sure who it was. They said, you know, who did you pitch this to before starting, and did they get it? And I would say 7 out of 10 didn't get it. Wait, you're going to take the oldest wrestling brand, which everyone thought every NWA fan is 50 plus, and create a digital product that's only available on a platform like YouTube, which you could argue 50 plus is not really, you know, that's not where the kids watch YouTube. And that's the exact point on why we created. But the platform of something like YouTube and social media, one of the first things we did was find these old pictures that tied to the brand. And I don't think this idea would have worked 10 years ago or 15 years ago because Google wasn't mature enough. YouTube wasn't mature enough. Now, if you want to look up Luthez, there's plenty of Luthez to look up. If you want to look up Dusty Rhodes, there's plenty of Dusty Rhodes. So when Brian Last and a couple people, and this is no heat on Brian or anybody, they didn't understand what we were doing. This brand has such power, and I don't even think we've even come close to harnessing it yet. It has such a – people have such a warm and fuzzy about it that we announced the return of a Crockett Cup, a tournament that was 3 years running and was only really good 1 year. It was only really successful 1 year. The Baltimore was the most critical and financially successful of it. And yet people still are so excited for this thing to come back because it's tied to an era that people feel really into. And the Crockett era is so fascinating because it's very similar to today. And there's a lot of changes going on in the business. But here we are, the NWA, and all this craziness. And we're this little engine that could. The show, the YouTube show, it's not the most watched thing on YouTube. It's not. It is there. And I'm very – would I love more viewers? Yeah, but I find the depth of the people who do watch and the people who talk to me about it, it's really a labor of love. And I was telling a friend who also creates YouTube content and has a much larger channel – than the NWA one, about how meticulous I am, at times over meticulous with it, because I wanted to engage you in a way that you don't see coming. And, you know, creating content, there's a lot of people who create a lot of very sort of standard issue content. You know, I left the podcast world in 2011 when I went to work at TNA, and I never went back because the genre has been flooded with everybody and nobody's creating differently. If I were ever to do a podcast again, it would be such a different format because you have to be different. You have to go the other way. So the idea that we can tell the NWA story on a weekly basis in a 5 to 15 minute video, that's sort of this mix master version of what's happening in the NWA. Like the episode I'm working on now is content that I shot 3 weeks ago when we were in Charlotte doing the site survey. But it's peaking with, you know, the new content I shot with Cornette this week, the announcement of two promotions that are going to be sending teams that are from around the world. Like this is a way that it's almost like a living documentary of this brand's resurgence. And I don't think people understand we're literally documenting everything. And so if you wanted to start today, you could start episode one and go all the way through and live through this whole thing. And we're not retelling the history. We're telling the history as it's happening.
Throughout 2017 and 2018, we've watched the WWE sign more talent than they have slots for on any given program. There are rumblings that talents are becoming restless, sitting on the sidelines. From your experience, has the WWE a potential problem on their hands with this situation? And what does that mean for other wrestling promotions like the NWA?
WWE signed two television deals that earned them billions upon billions of dollars. Talents are very happy with their money. Creative is always it's been that way since the dawn of time. Two cavemen sat in a cave arguing over who got the lead. The unhappiness is not a new thing. It happens in all environments. There are people unhappy with their shifts at their jobs. What has to happen is quality communication. I don't work there. I haven't worked at WWE in 11 years. I don't know what their environment is. I don't know how the process is. I know our process, and we have a very small roster of 3 to 4 talents under deals. The best way to work with talent is to find out what they want and either work with them to go towards what they want or let them understand what you want and work towards getting them there together. The opportunity that comes, and it's a great time to be a creator in the world because it's never been easier to create content and to monetize yourself and build a brand. The most successful pay-per-view of this year that wasn't a boxing pay-per-view or UFC, mainstream boxing, was Logan Paul and KSI, built up on 2 YouTube shows, and they did 700,000 buys at $10 a pop on YouTube alone. It means that anyone can create conflict at any time. WWE has a very established format that they do very well with. Now, people will say, aren't their TV ratings down? Yes. Television ratings in general are down. This was the lowest rated Super Bowl in I think, 10 years. Why? Because there was no conflict. Everyone's seen the Patriots win. Everyone's seen the Patriots lose. The Rams were not a strong opponent. It's all about how people match up. You know, the success we had this year with Cody Rhodes and Nick Aldis was we built a very strong story, and both guys came out better on either side, from a creative and, for one, a financial side. And I think that's what's really good is to create stories that lead to these pivots in the wrestling business. As far as talents unhappy in WWE, they sign contracts. And that's on. And we all face a choice when we accept a job to understand what we're walking into. The creative environment in WWE has been the same since 1998. It's been the same company executing the same format. If you're not happy, you face a decision. Do I continue working at my job? Do I speak to my boss, find out what I can do better, and then try and execute it? So as far as talents who are coming available, I think it's a great time to explore it. I won't say the grass isn't always greener. I've been more successful outside of WWE because I've put in a work, but I've also expanded my skill set. And I think that's important to always be evolving. And I think these talents face a similar thing. Cody Rhodes and the Young Bucks are now executive vice presidents of AEW. That is not a skill set they had 6 months ago. And they're going to learn the job of what's necessary. I'm learning how to run a wrestling company. I've always sort of been in creative or managed talent. But to have to manage it all, it is an ever-evolving business in an ever-evolving time.
Very good. Very good. Speaking of conflict and matchups, I'm going to go on and bring in the other co-host, Laura. She has some questions for you, Dave. Now watch her now. She can be conflicting. So
are you
watch
salty,
her.
Laura?
No. I do apologize, Mr. Lagana, for being late. I did have to get my hair did, so I do apologize for that.
Wow. Yeah, I told him you had something important to do.
Well, that is important.
Well, okay. All right. I guess it is.
It is important, especially when you can't get in but every 6 weeks. So.
Your hair's got to be perfect for this interview. For a podcast interview, you have to have your hair perfect.
Perfect
exactly.
Hair.
See,
yeah.
he
requirement.
Understands.
I get
the
it. I'm enough. Yep, enough for me. Okay.
It is a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you very much for coming on the show. I'm just curious. I'm an NWA girl, Crockett girl, grew up with that Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling every Saturday. Who came up with the idea or the concept of having a world heavyweight champion treat the indies much like the territories were treated, to have an NWA champion come and visit different independent companies and defending the title, much like Flair and Race and Dusty did back in the day?
Yeah, we faced a situation when Billy and I purchased the brand, exploring that we had, I think, it's either 21 or 31 territories people that had paid a license fee to the previous owner, Bruce Tharp. And then I found out none of them had executed contracts. And so I went to all of them and said, listen, your agreements that you believe you have run through October 1st. None of them could produce executed agreements from Bruce Tharp. I was very sort of they were still operating businesses, so it was not my business to worry about. But I let them know that I was going to let them have access to all the titles from, I believe it was the beginning of May when we agreed in principle to purchase the company, to October 1st, and that to run business as usual, and then any sort of controversial decisions in the transfer period I would handle. At the time, that's when I met Tim Storm, and you know, Tim is a very good man, as obviously you guys have met and spoken to him, like very quality, salt of the earth human
yes.
being. And, you know, he was going to these territories, and I asked him a lot of questions, and the situation came up of a promoter who wasn't NWA affiliated, who offered him five figures to drop the title to somebody to screw us over. And what we had learned was, affiliated or not, a lot of these promoters are very selfish. And I think I alluded to that earlier, people that wanted to use the NWA to make sure they felt big in their town. When you put yourself above the logo, then you should not be part of that logo. So to answer your question on when we had Tim as the champion, we looked at what did people really love about the NWA? And at the core, in its an incarnation of the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, into the 80s, it was about that world champion touring. So the mistake of the territories of this current era, it just doesn't exist. Like a territory, the way it existed in the 60s and 70s, is not how it exists in the 2000s and 2000 whatever 10s. It doesn't exist the same way. So why not work with promotions that want to work with us? And we worked with a lot of different companies, some positive, some negative, some didn't like it, some did. But there was no affiliation. So instead of getting the logo, they got a world title match at a very fair value. They also got exposure in this new YouTube series, and they got to be part of this story moving forward of everything somebody loved. And that was sort of – and we didn't promise them we're going to take over the world and you're going to be this and you're going to be that. We were just honest with people, and we pushed good energy and transparency. And in a world full of carnies and con men, we're the outliers.
Right. You definitely hit the nail on the head about in a world full of carnies and con men. That's for sure.
Yeah. People have taken advantage of people in the business, fans, and partners in the business for years for the hope of finding that infinite source of money. But you have to put the audience first. And, you know, again, I put a lot of time into 10 pounds of gold, and I always think, will somebody want to watch this? Will somebody enjoy watching this? And will they get something that moves their feelings forward? Feelings are very important to me as far as the storytelling aspect of this brand, because people feel about it. You don't hear a lot of people, I think people actually bemoan the missing AWA at times, but like there are certain brands that people just, you know, ECW had a very fervent fan base. I was one of them. Once you're over with an audience, it can then lead to a lot of very good things, but also can be abused if it's not properly taken care of.
Exactly. And, you know, for me, seeing, you know, when I was growing up, Ric Flair wasn't on TV every week because he was out doing this and that and the other. When we come in, you know, oh my gosh, it's the world champion. This is awesome. But with that, and the traveling, you spoke with my boyfriend and his friend at the Ring of Honor show in Concord, and you had mentioned to them that you wanted to sell out Cabarrus Arena at some point. So I'm just curious. That's awesome. I totally think you guys can do it. I'm just curious. Do you have plans to do shows in some other NWA staple towns, like, for example, you know, Atlanta, or maybe, you know, somewhere in Texas or in Florida? And I just want to throw this out here that little old Roanoke, Virginia was a great NWA town and still is a great wrestling town. So I'm just going to throw that city out there for you to maybe, you know, keep in the back of your head to maybe bring some NWA back to Roanoke.
Yeah, I think the important thing is, and this is a risk, this Cabarrus show. It's definitely bigger. You know, everything we've done two shows. Now, All In was not our show, but we obviously had a large piece of one of the attractions that people anticipated, enjoyed, and to this day still talk about. We are very cautious about running. You know, there's a guy in Michigan and a guy in Miami who hit me up. When are you going to run a show? When the market demands it. You know what I mean? When the right. opportunity. And that's why we created the pop-up brand. You know, and here we took the logo, but to work with somebody like Crimson and Tried and True and Clarksville, they run very good shows. So we knew there was already installed base of fans that had been exposed to the NWA's return. So for us to be able to walk in with a larger thing and put the brand up in the town and give them an attraction, while a very polarizing attraction of David Arquette in a hair match, which it's funny that people argued that that's not what the NWA is. Go look at the history of the NWA. It is probably one of the more eclectic brands. I mean, I remember Starrcade, I think it was 85, of Jimmy Valiant versus Paul Jones with Big Mama's
yes.
hair on the line. And, yes. you know, so and that match sold tickets because people cared about the Boogie Woogie Man. You know, people
sure
cared
did.
About, like, and, like, that. So when people tell me what this brand is and isn't, I can throw as many examples of what it is and isn't as well. And so for a place like Roanoke, which I've been to with WWE, and a place like Atlanta, which Nick Aldis defended the NWA title on an episode of Ring of Honor that airs this weekend,
right.
and we'll put the match on the YouTube channel at Center Stage, the first time the NWA championship was in that venue since 1993, and I think it's honestly the first time the 10 pounds of gold has actually been in that venue. We're looking to make history and do firsts, and so to walk into the Cabarrus Arena and the video I'm doing right now, it's, you know, Billy walks in and it's quite vast, you know, and Ring of Honor just ran it. And our hope is to sell out not only how it's scaled for 2,105, I think. And I might have just made that mm-hmm. number up. But if we push the curtain back, it can be 4,000. Now, do I think we're
yeah.
going to sell out all 2,000? I really hope so, and that's my goal. And if you don't have the goal of selling every seat, then you need to focus on what you want to accomplish, and that's the goal. And, you know, we've been very strategic on this. We had a very nice pre-sale tomorrow, and obviously this airs later, but, you know, the first day of tickets on sale, you know, right before tickets go on sale, we're going to announce two more partners that are joining for the show. We'll be sending teams, and we're hopefully going to build attractions that make people really want to see what's going to happen. And that's what's interesting about the story of this brand is it's an underdog. The oldest promotion in the United States, the most historic, is an underdog. And we're not out there banging our chests that we're going to change the world. We just want to bring back something that people love in places they love it.
Well, you can't go wrong with the Charlotte area as far as wrestling goes. Storied history there. Just about any promotion that runs there does very well, no matter what facility they use. So,
yeah.
hey, good luck. I hope you guys do sell out, certainly.
Well, and it takes good word of mouth. And, you know, I'm happy to just, like, there are so many different fans. And there was somebody today who was just lamenting about that they don't like what we're doing with this version of the NWA and how it should be this and should be that. Again, it is what we make it, and it's the energy that we're behind it, and we're honoring. You know, we're not holding steadfast. Vince McMahon said, "Show me the stone. Show me the stone where these rules were written." You know, this is a
right.
very sort of very loosey goosey wrestling business where it's all about what is happening to entertain the fans, and tastes change. So just because something happened in 1986. As long as you bounce off the same energy and take care of what's best for the fans, then that's what we're looking to do. Not, you can't do that because in 1986 it was done this way. Well, you know what? People used to read the newspaper. How many people read the newspaper on a daily basis? So you have to adapt with the times, but also, you know, but news just moves faster, and so does the wrestling business. And I think as long as we stick to what is the core values of the brand, tradition and legacy, I think we'll be moving forward in a positive direction.
I totally agree. I could not agree more. I do have to ask you, I'm going to put you on the spot just a little bit. Do you have any exclusives that you could give us, like who's going to be Willie Mack's opponent Anything good and juicy Scoop? That you could give us?
Wait. I thought that people pay for this stuff. Scoop?
Yeah, you know.
Here it comes.
My PayPal, my Venmo, my Cash.
Here it comes.
I'm a big believer. Well, that's my favorite. People were like, the guy got real angry at me. I think it was a woman. I'm not sure in England. Are you going to announce the teams that are going to be in Crockett Cup? And I just wrote back, yes. They're like, well, who are they? I was like, would you like to go through my email? And it's just like, we like to release information in a timely manner that it's released to the maximum effect. I can tell you right now, even though this is going to air after the fact, who these two promotions are, but there is a coordinated effort for that information to hit right before tickets go on sale. And not that I would think that you guys would run off and tell people, but that's just the decision we made because that's what's best for our audience. And while it's best for your audience that I give you the scoop, it's not best for my audience. Well, and it's we live in a world of who wants to be first and not what's right for the audience. Like, I despise that fans know what's going to happen. I think that is that makes people not want to like it's I don't know who that serves. And like, no, if I could tell you the finish of WrestleMania right now, would you want to know it? Like,
no.
That's the part that I don't understand. And that's the world we live in, where everyone wants to rush to be, I know this. Well, I want to be, I felt this. And that's the difference between, I think, how we present our product and how other people who just want to be the first to put their flag in the ground that I knew this first. That doesn't help the overall general larger audience.
I understand, but you got to give a girl, you know, a girl's got to try. So.
You're going to get my answer, which most people don't like. And usually I ended up getting blocked by that person who was not happy that I didn't tell him who the teams were 16 weeks ago.
Well,
they weren't going to buy a ticket to the show anyway. So
Right.
It's all good.
I'm curious. I looked on your Twitter a little bit and was curious. Does Monkey the Cat observe you all the time or just when you're talking on the phone about wrestling?
Well, you have dazzled Monkey so well with your interview skills that he is asleep. Yes, he's asleep. So,
I have that effect on people. I truly do.
So do I. The cat, not funny story on the cat. So, you know, I adopted this cat 2 months ago. I was looking to rescue an animal, and his name was listed as Monkey. And this goes back to the previous discussion we were just having. And why I kept it Monkey, because I actually I got him the day Dynamite Kid died. And for a moment, I thought about naming him Dynamite, because I was a huge Dynamite Kid fan. And I know people would then go, yeah, but Dynamite Kid was a horrible person. Why did you name your cat that? So I stuck with Monkey for a while. And there's a phrase I always kind of reference, and I think I referenced it when I posted the first picture of him. A lot of people worry about other people's problems. I need to worry. And so when I would go off into the weeds worrying about, well, that person's doing this and this person's doing this. It's not my circus. It's not my monkey. So this is my monkey, and he lives in my circus. And he's honestly, it's one of the best things I ever did, because this cat, not to bore you with the tribulations of this poor cat, you know, he had a previous owner. He's chipped. He got out. He was on his own in the wild for a period of 8 months. They found him. They found his owner, and the owner didn't want him. And so he sat in this pet store in Fairview, Tennessee, which is in the middle of nowhere. I found him online. I went to look at him, and they told me nobody came to look at him or adopt him. It was the first person in 2 months. And as he claws at me right now because he hears me talking about him, you know, he was very shy and very timid, and he sat. When I brought him home, he sat in this box, like I have, you know, like a towel thing in your bathroom, like it's not a towel rack, but like where you put your towels, like storage. He sat in there because it was what he was comfortable with. And for the 2 months, you know, he's as he now lays on his back, like, which if you've ever owned a cat knows that they're very comfortable with that. It's been such a experience for me to take this animal that was afraid of everything and needed to be protected to, well, now he's laying on his back, legs spread, like he is a young lady at a rock concert after a few a few margaritas. And, you know, he's very happy. He doesn't hide as much. And, you know, he still has his moments. But, like, to me, that's growth. And to me, this is a great story. And the reason that we looked at the brand, the NWA, the same way, it needed a lot of love and care. And instead of running the Cabarrus Arena on October 1st, 2017, we're running it on April 27th, 2019, because it took time. Trust me, I've wanted to do the Crockett Cup since 1988. I am a giant wrestling nerd, and I've always wanted to book a Starrcade. Maybe one day I will get to book it and get to have the name. Anything is possible in 2019. And just so you know, you can't text Monkey and try to get scoops, because I think Meltzer tried that with my last cat, and it didn't work out.
Oh, well, dang it. There goes my plan. Dang it.
Yeah.
One last question for you. This also comes from me, you know, stalking you on Twitter a little bit. I want to know who wins in this match, Gladys Knight, the Empress of Soul, or Asuka, the Empress of Tomorrow?
Ah, I enjoy when cultural moments happen, and, you know, I heard Empress, I'm like, oh, she's the Empress of Tomorrow. I think, well, obviously Asuka would win because she is younger and, you know, her skill, like, although Gladys looked like she could still go. Aretha Franklin sung at WrestleMania 23, and I would say perhaps Aretha Franklin at WrestleMania 23. I know she's passed recently. Might stand up better than Gladys Knight because she just was a little bigger. You know, it'd be harder for Gladys to take her down. So maybe we'll do like a three-way dance on a computer somewhere, and Monkey can send you the spoiler alert when he's ready. So
that sounds awesome. Like a plan.
That's awesome.
I mean, if you saw him right now, he looks like a. I don't know what he looks like. He's just all sprawled out. This is quite a thing we're looking at here.
Dave has mentioned it several times before, but we'll mention it again. Tickets for the Crockett Cup 2019, which will be held April 27th at Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina. Tickets for this, it was announced today via an email, will go on sale to the general public on Friday, February the 8th at 10 a.m. I have that correct, Dave? Is that is correct, right?
By the time people are listening to this, they're on sale. Most likely they're already on sale. You know, we have not only do we have obviously the promotions that are sending teams like Ring of Honor and NWA, we have obviously legends like Jim Cornette, the original, not the original Midnight Express, but Jim Cornette's both versions of the Midnight Express, the Rock and Roll Express, Magnum TA and Nikita Koloff, and we hope to announce more legends as we find who's available and who's willing to come to the show. And it's going to be a celebration of Jim Crockett Promotions, and I'm hoping that the Crocketts come. You know, the Jim Crockett has been very sort of coy about going to I don't think he's actually been to a wrestling event. I know he did a couple fan fests, but, you know, our hope is that he wants to come. Our hope that he wants to have a moment at the show, because the Crockett family deserves it. You know, the Crocketts, you know, promoted wrestling in that area for 50 plus years. And, you know, they led to what became modern day WCW and led to, you know, they deserve to understand what they did for the business. And that's why, honestly, we wanted to continue the Crockett Cup, you know, because it gives them a piece of legacy. Like, I don't think a lot of people know who Stanley is of the Stanley Cup. You know, Lord Stanley, and I don't even know who he is, but this trophy is named after him. And for us,
right,
and the legacy of the NWA, the Crocketts are very important. And we really hope they'll be there. And anyone that ever went to see a Crockett event, you know, our hope is to create an event that is as close to that event as possible. We hope when people walk in on April 27th, they walk into 1985. I'll tell you, and I told somebody else, there will be no LED screens. It will be as close to 1985 as possible.
Oh, my.
Because that is what we're trying to create, as an event that feels as authentic and as close to the nostalgia, but being retro forward.
Very cool. So for fans that want to keep up with the NWA for this event, the Crockett Cup, and any other NWA event, including the pop-up events, make sure that you're following the NWA on Twitter, at NWA. Make sure that you're subscribing to the NWA on YouTube. Dave, thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule to be with us. We certainly appreciate the time and can't thank you enough. It's been an honor to have you on the show.
It has been.
Thank you.
An honor and a pleasure, yes.
Awesome. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
Hey everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Mary.
Live from the Armory Wrestling Show is heard worldwide. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on Blog Talk Radio. But this is an FNX.network plug, which means we're heard from Mobile, Alabama to Melbourne, Australia. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Check us out on FNX.network. What do you say, Laura?
Been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network, and we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.